Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have again brought us together on the Lord's Day to praise you for your goodness and ask for your blessing. Give us grace to see your hand in the week that is past and your purpose in the week to come, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. A word of welcome this morning to St. Luke's Cathedral on the Sunday which we celebrate the Harvest Festival, the goodness of our God as we bring in the fields and crops on this day. Dear friends in Christ, let us turn our hearts and minds to worship Almighty God, and let us confess our sins. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways
to the glory of your name. Amen. Merciful God, grant to your people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was alive and raised with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 262. Come, ye thankful people, come. shepherds of all things, give us grateful hearts for all your goodness and steadfast will to use your bounty well, that the whole human family, today and in generations to come, may with us give thanks for the riches of your creation. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with flowing streams, with springs and underground waters welling up in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land where you may eat bread without scarcity, where you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and from whose hills you may mine copper. You shall eat your fill and bless the Lord your God for the good land that he has given you. Take care that you do not forget the Lord your God by failing to keep his commandments, his ordinances, and his statutes, which I am commanding you today. When you have eaten your fill and have built fine houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks have multiplied, and your silver and gold is multiplied, and all that you have is multiplied, then do not exalt yourself, forgetting the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrible wilderness, an arid wasteland with poisonous snakes and scorpions. He made water flow for you from flint rock and fed you in the wilderness with manna that your ancestors did not know, to humble you and to test you, and in the end to do you good. Do not say to yourself, my power and the might of my own hand have gained me this wealth. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, so that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your ancestors, as he is doing today. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The appointed psalm is Psalm 65. Praise is due to you, O God, in Zion, and to you shall vows be performed.
O you who answer prayer, to you all flesh shall come.
When deeds of iniquity overwhelm us, you forgive our transgressions.
Happy are those whom you choose and bring near to live in your courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of your house, your holy temple.
By awesome deeds you answer us with deliverance, O God of our salvation. You are the hope of all the ends of the earth and of the farthest seas.
By your strength you establish the mountains. You are girded with might.
You silence the roaring of the seas, the roaring of their waves, the tumult of the peoples.
Those who live at earth's farthest bounds are awed by your signs. You make the gateways of the morning and the evening shout for joy.
You visit the earth and water it. You greatly enrich it. The river of God is full of water. You provide the people with grain, for so you have prepared it.
You water its furrows abundantly, settling its ridges, softening it with showers, and blessing its growth.
You crown the year with your bounty. Your wagon tracks overflow with richness.
The pastures of the wilderness overflow. The hills gird themselves with joy.
The meadows clothe themselves with flocks. The valleys deck themselves with grain. They shout and sing together for joy. Lord God, joy marks your presence. presence. Beauty, abundance, and peace are the tokens of your work in all creation. Work also in our lives, that by these signs we may see the splendor of your love and praise you through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ, and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with all others, while they long for you and pray for you, because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you. Thanks be to God for this indescribable gift. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts and minds be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. We come together today to mark Harvest Thanksgiving, a blessed and joyous and wondrous time. And I know it's the right time. I look at the beautiful display that's been set upon our altar steps of God's great bounty in creation. I also know it's the right time because in the last week or so I was given a beautiful bag of the sweetest apples that was grown on a neighbor's front lawn. And I was able to buy local corn. I've been buying corn on the cob from the grocer week by week almost all year round. But the local corn at the full time of harvest, picked from the stalk just an hour before. Well, it's a time to be thankful. It's a time to be thankful. And with Harvest Thanksgiving, we come together and we're called to see afresh, with fresh eyes, the wonder of God's grace and power breaking into our creation with the harvest God calls and desires. And it's a good and wondrous thing. And we might expect at such a time as this that the gospel reading would call from the scriptures those beautiful passages we associate with the wonders of creation. The promise of God saying he would bring his people to a land flowing with milk and honey, with bountiful harvests, being able to fill up the grain sheds. We might expect perhaps some of the parables of Jesus that speak of the shepherd, or of the sower of the seeds, of the wonder of the bounty of scattering seed and how it grows, of the vine and the fruit. We'd expect those things well as a gospel to be appointed for such a day as this. But the principal gospel reading appointed for Harvest Thanksgiving isn't any of those, but a healing passage. The story of 10 lepers who call out to Jesus as he's traveling through a village as he approaches Jerusalem. They call out to have Jesus show them mercy. And this we have to understand in the context of seeing afresh the wonder of God's graciousness breaking into God's creation, God's bounty. How is it so? Why would it be? I don't know if any of you had had the opportunity in recent times to visit Toronto, perhaps not during these COVID times, but if you visit Toronto and go into the downtown area, it's not unusual at all to see panhandlers, people begging, asking for some small token. Toronto the good, as it's so often known. Toronto is known to have the most polite panhandlers in the world. Maybe it's because we're Canadians that we're always polite. We say please and thank you. But there's so much more of it than that. If you wander the downtown streets of Toronto, you are most likely to see a panhandler who will not come up to you aggressively, but may sit quietly with a cup in front of them and maybe make eye contact. Some are known to wish you a good morning and a good day and maybe ask if perhaps you have some extra change. Never are you accosted or assaulted. Even for those who don't offer the panhandlers change, I've witnessed the panhandlers wishing them a good day and even a God bless you as they go by. The most polite of panhandlers. We might think there's something special going on. Indeed, there's something we need to know. Because what's going on in that exchange and those contacts with the politeness isn't something about being Canadian or anything else. It's about an important social contract that we have in our society. It's a blessed thing that we have a good social safety net, although we clearly know it's not enough. It's wondrous to know that there are agencies and organizations and faith groups who are busy day by day by day reaching out and doing all that they can to make the lives of those who are destitute and in despair and whose lives are broken, to do what they can to lift them up. And we know it's not enough. So we have a social convention that allows for people to gather in the streets and ask for help in the politest of ways, so that they might get some little leg up to get through the day. So long as they don't make the people around them uncomfortable or frightened or feel heavily put upon. It's a social contract of a gentle politeness so that we might all get along in this together. And it's not enough. And it's not enough. If we hear the gospel story today, we find, again, one of those social contracts going on. When we hear it as people of faith, so much knowing of the wonders of Jesus' healing ministry and his casting out demons and the miracles that he's done, we tend to hear the exchange between the lepers and Jesus of one of great and profound faith, where the lepers are coming desperate to have their condition changed in miraculous ways, and Jesus doing so by the grace of God. And indeed, that's the outcome. But it's not the context. It's not the context. Indeed, what's happening at that moment is much a part of a social contract as what I've described with the panhandlers in downtown Toronto. The lepers are behaving in the way that they are allowed to. They are broken and destitute and alone and sick. And they're allowed to stand at a distance and call out to neighbors and passersby for mercy, hoping to get some little thing to help them through the day. Perhaps get them enough to buy their daily bread. And the exchange initially goes exactly as they would have expected. I don't think any of those 10 were calling to Jesus, recognizing him as the Son of God, but recognizing him as someone who has spoken a great purpose for God's life and the world and mercy upon it, and they're hoping he will show mercy on them and give them something from his purse. And his response, likewise, is probably something they absolutely expected. He told them to go and see the priest. Show yourself to the priests. In that day and age, those lepers, the only people that they could go and see and come anywhere near to were the priests, who were responsible to give the alms and care out into the community where it was needed, to examine those who were sick or broken or outcast, to see if they were fit enough to enter back into the fellowship of the community, and if not, give them enough for that day to survive. And so they went. And so they went. But that's when the wondrous thing happened. What nobody on the streets of that little village in Galilee would have thought. 10 lepers were wondrously made clean. And their eyes were not restored for that day, but for the rest of their lives. And for everyone to see it. And one of those 10 saw with fresh eyes what had happened and turned and ran to Jesus and fell prostrate before him, giving thanks and praising God because the wondrous thing had happened, more than he could have asked or imagined. He had been made whole, and the bounty of his life was restored. When we go day by day by day offering comfort and hope to those who are destitute, whose lives are broken and lives are scattered, we are doing faithfully and as best we can to follow in the way and the intention of God. And God desires that we do this and follow in that way. When we recognize the wonder of the power of God to change lives and bring that message forth, we too are seeing creation with the fresh eyes of the Samaritan, who was then prepared anew to proclaim the wonder of what God can do in this world. In this world, no one is hungry because truly there's not enough food. No one is lonely because there isn't enough love in the world. No one suffers oppression because there isn't the power and intention of God to see that justice is done. What we see in the harvest of God is the capacity and desire and longing of God to show that to the world and have us join with Him in the work of the bounty of the harvest He intends for all creation. It was said by Jesus that the faith of the one who had come to Him was what had made him well. 1 out of 10. But God's bounty was such to make that made known that He healed them all. God desires the binding up and the healing and the feeding and the preservation and wonder of all of creation. But He desires from you and from me to see with fresh eyes that work of God in this place and to proclaim it and to join with it. That is why we can stand together and be thankful for His harvest. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Let us confess our faith as we say,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. For the beauty and wonder of creation.
We thank you, Lord.
For all that is gracious in the lives of men and women, revealing the images of Christ.
We thank you, Lord.
For our daily food, for our homes and families and friends.
We thank you, Lord.
For minds to thank and hearts to love.
We thank you, Lord.
For health, strength, and skill to work, and for leisure to rest and play.
We thank you, Lord.
For those who are brave and courageous, patient in suffering, and faithful in adversity.
We thank you, Lord.
For all who pursue peace, justice, and truth.
We thank you, Lord.
For the province of the Episcopal Church of Sudan, the Most Reverend Zigo Kumir Kondo, Archbishop of the Province of Sudan and Bishop of Khartoum. We give special thanks for St. Michael's and All Angels, Thunder Bay, the Reverend Nancy Ringham, Intrim, and the lay readers of the Diocese of Algoma as they participate in their online conference hosted by the Deanery of Temiskaming, and for the ministries of all lay readers in the parishes, deaneries, and dioceses. We also give special thanks for our bishops and clergy. Our Archbishop and Metropolitan Anne, our Primate Linda, our Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin, our Dean, James, Archdeacon Harry and Hugh, honorary assistants.
We thank you, Lord.
For St. Luke, and all the saints whose lives have reflected the light of Christ.
We thank you, Lord.
Accept, O Lord, our thanks and praise for all you have done for us. We thank you for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. We thank you for the blessing of family and friends, and for the loving care which surrounds us on every side. We thank you for setting us tasks which demand our best efforts, and for leading us to accomplishments which satisfy and delight us. We thank you also for those disappointments and failures that lead us to acknowledge our dependence on you alone. Above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience by which he overcame temptation, for his dying through which he overcame death, for his rising to life again, in which we are raised to the life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we may know Christ and make him known, and through him at all times and in all places, may give thanks to you in all things.
Amen.
Gathering our prayers and praises into one, let us pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. The kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Glory to God,
whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine.
Glory to God from generation to generation,
in the Church and in Christ Jesus,
forever and ever.
Amen.
Our final hymn this morning is hymn number 429, For the Beauty of the Earth.
Spirit.
Amen. Amen.